MashaAllah, it's good to see that from all parts of the world, people from different nations coming to worship to this one country and giving different flavors of Islam, Islamic culture, and different mazahibs also. As Islam by its nature is universal, it's a universal religion. And it is an invitation to all of mankind to come to your Creator, to worship your Creator, to know your Creator. And this invitation is issued through prophets, and the last prophet, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being their crown and their the summit of the tree of prophethood, and indeed the heart of it, because his message is for until the day of resurrection and supersedes all previous messages. But essentially, there is no difference. They are all calling to the one God, and they are all saying, as for his creation, be respectful and be kind, be just and be fair. And that is the meaning of غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ, meaning be in the center, in the middle path, أُمَّةً وَسَطَ, or in another verse, the tree that is neither of the east nor of the west, meaning not from this extreme or from that extreme. Like Imam said, that it is not that we are for one nation, no, we are for all Muslims. So in the same sense, Islam is not for one people at the exclusion of others, but for all mankind. And our Rabb is Rabbil Alameen, and he is Rabbil Nas and Ilah Nas, yani all people. One time I was asked, well, why does he say Hudan lil Muttaqeen then? Is it guidance only for the Muttaqeen? It is not sent as a guidance only for those who are already muttaqeen, but rather it increases the muttaqeen in guidance. However, a little later on, it says, "Unzila fihi al-Qur'an hudan lil-nas." Shahru Ramadan alladhi unzila fihi al-Qur'an hudan lil-nas. So it is hudan lil-nas. So there is different types of hudan. Hudan in the sense of invitation to guidance, and then hudan lil muttaqin in the sense of if you come and if you take care of your iman, if you cultivate your faith and obey Allah, Allah is going to give you more guidance until subhanallah you can make it through this life safe and sound, because this life is a test and full of fitna from ourselves and from outside ourselves as well. So if you are able to navigate that, then you will be safe. And that is the whole goal, to come out of this life safe and sound. And the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, truly the actions are count only according to their final states or their conclusions. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ. So we are looking for the Khatima, and we are preparing for the Khatima, the conclusion of our lives. That's when we want to leave this earth with full rida of accepting Allah as our Lord. رَضِينَ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّا. We accept and we are pleased and happy with Allah as our Lord. وَبِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا. And with Islam as our religion. وَبِ Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam nabiyyan wa rasula. And we are pleased with Muhammad as our prophet and messenger. Wa bil Qur'an imaman. And with the Qur'an as our book. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you recite this at the end of the day, And if Allah takes back your soul that night, you will die as a shaheed. And if you recite it at the beginning of the day after Salat al-Fajr also, and during that day you die, Allah will write you as a shaheed. See, there are so many types of shaheed in Islam. Shahada, because shaheed means one who is bearing witness with his whole life, with her whole life, with their whole life, that Allah is our Lord, and so forth. So that's the point. And in understanding the many different aspects of the worship that is required of us, of the transactions of life, how we are supposed to negotiate them, and of the relationship with Allah, with his Prophet, with his book, with the people who are in leadership, and with the common Muslims and the common masses of the people, how are we supposed to act in every context, and also all of the private sphere of life, or of the habitual spheres of life, eating, drinking, and so forth. The Prophet ﷺ left so many instructions, and the Holy Quran is so comprehensive that it needs explanation, further explanation of how this all works. This explanation was given by the Sahaba al-Kiram, which they took from the Prophet ﷺ, and after that the successors, and after the successors came the first of the founders of formal mazahibs. In reality, when we say mazhab or school of law, we mean approach and methodology which might differ from one Sahabi to the other. There were among the Sahabi, not all of them, they were giving fatwa, for example. Some of them, they were more qualified than others. So there are levels and hierarchies among the Sahaba. Also, not all of the Sahaba spent the same large, equal amount of time with the Prophet ﷺ. Some spent more than others. Some also were related to him, either by blood or by marriage, so they had more access to him in a way that others did not. Some were more senior and knew him from even before the message. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what it matters to us is that we know that he gave his Prophet the best of families that he gave any Prophet, and the best of companions also that he gave any Prophet. We believe this firmly. This is an important point, because when we say وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ, the personal pronoun there is the same, the one and the same. This is an important point. I repeat, when we say وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ, we are referring to the Al of Prophet, the Ashab of Prophet. It all relates back to him. So their greatness, the greatness of the Al and the Ashab, is in relation to the greatness of Prophet ﷺ. It is like saying the greatness of the Arabs. As Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu said, we would be nothing. We, the Arabs, would be nothing except for Islam. Islam is what raised us up in level. Meaning, the Prophet ﷺ bringing us the message. So because we are mansub now, we become connected to the Prophet ﷺ in this respect. And the Ummah of the Prophet, same thing. So we keep the honor of everything. To detract from the honor of the companions is to detract from the honor of the Prophet ﷺ. Similarly, to detract from the honor of the Al, the family of Prophet, is to detract from the honor of the Prophet ﷺ. And you know what that means, in fiqh. It means that you are angry with Allah Himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa hasha, wa iyaz billah. So these subsequent generations transmitted that and refined and codified and explained, and finally this was crystallized by the imams of fiqh, which had students who were listening to the study of the entire aspects of the Sharia as much as they could, And so different schools formed. Among them, the schools of Imam Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi'i, and Ahmad ibn Hanbal, which is the subject of this book, but also other schools, such as the school of Al-Awza'i in Beirut, and the school of At-Tabari, who started as a Shafi'i, but then you know he branched off into his own school. The school of Al-Layth ibn Sa'd in Egypt, whom Imam al-Shafi'i admired greatly. Other Imams of Medina, like Ibn Abi Layla also, that are representatives of the different schools of Medina, because the schools of Medina are several, not just one. So how come only four survived? That's what has survived. The others died out. Maybe they did not have enough students, or they survived for a while. The Mazhab of Sufyan al-Thawri also, who was a contemporary of Abu Hanifa, more or less, and lived also in Kufa. He had students, and until even the Imam al-Nawawi mentions the Mazhab of Sufyan al-Thawri and his school. Then there were some literalists also. Literalists, Dawood al-Zahiri, he's known as al-Zahiri because Zahiri means the literalist or externalist, in the sense that taking words literally in the interpretation of the Sharia. He started out as a Shafi'i, then became a literalist and developed his own school. And the greatest representative of that in later times became Ibn Hazm. Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri, who lived in Andalus. Also, there are other schools, and I try to mention these particular defunct schools within the time frame of each imam. So if they were in the time of this imam, I mention them in his chapter in order to give them proper respect. So I do mention some of the contemporaries of each of the imam of the imams in his own chapters, so as for us to complete a little bit the historical picture of their context. And I didn't do this as a typical or conventional biography, that the imam was born in such a place, and when he was small, he lived there, and there were such experiences that happened, or such historical events at the time, and so forth, with a chronological timeline like that from beginning to end of their lives. But rather, I just gave a quick description of them at the from the beginning, with their dates of birth and death. And then I try to show their greatness and their particularities, their contributions, their contemporaries, their some salient points that attach particularly to their lives and that typify them. And around those salient points, I build a narrative of greatness in order to show the greatness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them display and exert in the different fields of their life. Their contributions to jurisprudence, to language, to tafsir, the explanation of the Quran, to the knowledge of hadith and its transmission, and to the principles of interpretation and of judging jurisprudence, what became usul al-fiqh. And usul al-fiqh, the one who is credited with codifying this science, the principles of jurisprudence, is Imam al-Shafi'i, but he benefited from everything that had been done before, also of discussion. So I do mention, for example, that they are interconnected, these four imams, mashallah, and each one that came later benefited from the one that came before. So in this respect, they are always indebted to those that came before. And this is indeed the way in Islam, that we always recognize our debt to those that came before. Because the Quran did not reach us directly, no more than it reached the Sahaba directly, but it came through the Holy Prophet. The Sahaba recognized that immense debt through their huge love for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and gratitude that shows in their behavior, in their belief, in their poetry, and in their general demeanor and their immense respect, adab towards the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Similarly, the subsequent generation tried to maintain all of these aspects of the behavior of a Muslim towards the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, but in addition to that, also towards the generations between themselves and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, because also they took that role of transmitting that precious knowledge. So we are thankful. And as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم taught us, thank people. If you want to thank Allah first, you must thank people. If you have not given thanks to people, then you have not given thanks to Allah. So we give thanks to those who taught us Iman and Islam and knowledge all through the generations. And beginning, if we were born and raised in a Muslim family, beginning with our parents, our Muslim teachers, those who taught us Quran, with our shuyukh, with the all of the shuyukh of our time, as because they are like one body teaching the same love and faith to Allah and belief in Allah and His Messenger and His Book, and also those of past times and centuries. That's what we mean when we say the Salaf al-Salih. So in the loose sense, Salaf is everything that Salafa, that has passed, yani anything before us, before our time. All of that is, in the wide sense, our Salaf. But in the technical sense of Muslim historiography, it is the first three centuries, because the Prophet ﷺ praised those first three centuries specially, saying these are the best of times, or the best of people is my time, and then the one that follows it, then the one that follows it, or my century, then the next, then the next. So these first three centuries hold a very special place in our hearts, and the ideal of the Muslim is to identify always with the best behavior and the best representation of the Prophet's teachings and of the Quran's orders and commands and prohibitions. And so the best of people in representing that, of course, after the Prophet ﷺ, were these first three centuries. But that doesn't mean that the intervening centuries between them and us are to be ignored or discarded. On the contrary, these, the closer they are to us, the more the responsibility is on us to perpetuate the good that they brought us. And because that is what we know, that's what we have received. So we cannot claim to know what is out of sight and more in the past, directly like that, and to ignore the intervening centuries and our own contemporaries and our teachers, making a claim that we want to be more like the Salaf, therefore we jump over. That does not work. It does not work like that. Because in reality, if anyone who does that is just looking at the books and imagining that this is what they probably meant, this is what they must have practiced, because they read it in the books, so they become followers of books instead of taking their religion from the hearts of the Muslims and from the mouth of teachers. They are now turning to books. And this is not how the Prophet taught us. The Prophet said, as the Quran said, to keep company with the people of zikr, to keep company with the people of knowledge, to keep company with the truthful ones, to be with jama'ah, to take from them and watch who you are, you befriend as your friend, because you follow the religion of your friend. So watch who you choose as your friend. Therefore, to keep company. And there is no difference of opinion in this between all of the mazahibs. Like Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani said, he's famous as a Sufi sheikh, but he was also a Hanbali faqih. And he wrote books of fiqh also, as well as tasawwuf. And he said in Kitab al-Ghunya, which is a large encyclopedia in which there is many fiqhi discussions as well as ethical and Sufi discussions of manners and so forth, He said the sunnah of Allah, the practice of Allah with His servants, is that there should always be teacher and students for the transmission of knowledge until the day of Qiyamah, until the day of resurrection. And also Shaykh and Murids. Because this is how knowledge is acquired, not from books that were published by we don't know exactly who, and we don't know if they contain mistakes or not, and so forth. So for example, even the book of all books, the Holy Quran, was not transmitted as papyrus or as parchments that are written down and handed over like that, and then we memorize them like that. No, it was transmitted from the chests of those who had memorized it, who had received it from Rasulullah ﷺ live, direct, face to face, and he had received it from Sayyidina Jibreel like that, as sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from their chest to those who received that knowledge and memorization. And at no time the Ummah was lacking in those memorizers like that. From the hearts and the chests of the memorizers to those who received it from them. And this is how the transmission of knowledge is, through talqeen. Talqeen being the imparting the knowledge, conveying the knowledge with the tongue to the ears of those who are listening and taking it like that, through live transmission. And this is how those four imams also received their knowledge of Quran, their knowledge of Hadith, their knowledge of the fiqh, meaning the understanding, yani faqiha. Or faquha mean to understand completely, to understand all the corners of the issue that we are studying. So it is connected to ilm, connected to ma'rifah, and all of the synonyms of knowledge and acquisition of knowledge. But fiqh has this special status that it means a deep understanding, a good, solid, correct understanding. And this was confirmed by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he said, whoever Allah wants great goodness for them, they give them fiqh in the religion. Man yurid bihi Allahu khayran, whoever Allah wants for them great goodness, yufaqihu fi ddeen. He gives them fiqh in the religion. And we become interested to know the aspects of this issue, that it helps us to practice our religion better. And this is exactly the niyyah and the objective of these four imams, was to help the ummah to do that. And they helped the ummah in a way that was fulfilling the general obligation of the ummah that must know your religion, you must study what you practice so that you can do it first of all correctly, then you can help others do it correctly. Because Allah wants to be known and worshipped, but not just in any way that we decide. He wants to be known and worshipped as he ought to be known, as He deserves to be worshipped. And the best models of that are the prophets. So that's why Allah said, now look at the prophet. He is one of you, human species. You have no excuse after that, because you can see how he's doing. Take from him, he is the perfect model. So they took from him and they transmitted that, and this is what this is the conditions of knowledge of the religion in Islam, that we do not just make it up ourselves. We do not just say, because I think this is the best way, therefore I will do this. We're not like that. But we are bound and accountable and liable and tied to our Prophet ﷺ. And in order to reach that, we need to be tied through all the generations that took from him. And he himself said, for example, in the hadith that we mentioned last night, blessings to those who saw me and believed in me, and blessings to those who saw me and believed in me, and blessings to those who saw those who saw those who saw me and believed in me, and so on and so forth, like that. In other words, this chain of transmission is all connected back to the Prophet ﷺ. If we operate without this chain of transmission in the religion, then anyone can say anything. As one of the Salaf Salih said, Ibn al-Mubarak, al-isnadu min ad-din, the chain of transmission is part of our religion also. But if it were not for the chain of transmission, anyone can say anything. وَلَوْلَا الْإِسْنَادِ لَقَالَ مَنْ شَاءَ مَا شَاءَ. So, we are not in a vacuum. We are not left alone after the time of the Prophet ﷺ. No, we are as if the Prophet ﷺ is still among us in the person of those imams, of their successors, of those who took from them solidly the understanding of the religion, including the tafsir of the Quran, including the hadiths, including the meanings of hadith and its applications in the religion. So that we know also that the ayah and the hadith is pronounced correctly, that we are not making a mistake in saying something the Prophet never said. Basic mistakes like that. And also that it is applied correctly in everything, in laws of inheritance, in ibadat, in mu'amalat, meaning acts of worship, as well as transactions among ourselves. So, one of the salient features of Imam Abu Hanifa's life and his approach, his methodology, is to extract rulings in ways that maybe others, they look at the same text, the same evidence, but they do not see it because they do not think of it. And this is part of the brilliance of the great brilliance of these imams, is that they see what we do not see even when we are reading the same text. So there is a difference in the understanding. This is part of the yufaqihu fi din, gives them deep understanding of the religion. For example, why Hanafis, they pray Salatul Asr at later times than the other mazahibs? Because there are some reports where the Prophet ﷺ showed that the time extends or may start at a later time. They base themselves on some of these reports. But there is also a report in which the Prophet ﷺ said that a certain people were hired to work by the owner of a big garden, right? From beginning of the day until noon. And then another group of people were hired to work from the Asr time until Maghrib. And the owner gave the same amount to each of the two. And the first group said, but the others, they work less than us. And the owner said, but I promised to give you this, I'm giving you this, so I'm being fair to you. Now the fact that they work less than those who worked from noon to Asr, those who worked from Asr to Maghrib, shows that the time between Asr and Maghrib was shorter than the time between noon and Asr. So Asr must have started later. But no one read this hadith to deduce that Asr must have started. But this is one of the hadiths in which Abu Hanifa saw a proof also confirming the other hadiths in which the Prophet ﷺ had prayed Asr indeed later, when the shadow was double the object in the that was standing in the light of the sun. Whereas the other mazhabs, they say when the shadow is only one time the length of the object, that's when the time of Asr begins. So this is one way in which Imam Abu Hanifa, and there's several other ways, as you know, for example, when we go into communities that are mostly Shafi'i or that are mostly Maliki, so I try to show some of the aspects of differences and the reasoning behind it, because when you know the proof, then your heart is at peace, because you know that that proof is from Allah and His Prophet. You know that the proof is from the text of the religion. It is not from the imagination or from just logical reasoning without basis in the Quran and the Sunnah. There is always a return to the Quran and the Sunnah as the proof. And the more you discover of the proofs of each mazhab, the more you realize that differences between the mazahibs are in fact a hidden blessing, because they give more leeway and more possibility not to be wrong, but to be always on haqq and connected to the practice of the Prophet ﷺ. Imam Malik, for example, he had the chance to make his mazhab to be the mazhab of the whole ummah. When he came out with the Muwatta, the Caliph Harun al-Rashid said, you know, I want to take your Muwatta and I want to hang it on the Kaaba, and I want to make an announcement every Hajj that people, Muslims, from now on, they must follow his rulings. They must follow the rulings of the of this book and this Imam. But Imam Malik said, no, ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, don't do that. He said, why not? I thought you would be happy. He said, no, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent the Sahaba to different areas, and after he left this dunya, they went to Sham, they went to Misr, Egypt, or they went to Syria, Sham, they went to Iraq, Kufa and Basra, they went to Yemen, and some of them went to North Africa also. So each of them took from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam many hadiths, many rulings, much wisdom that maybe the other one did not have. Or maybe he heard it, but he heard other things that the first one did not, and so on and so forth. And then they taught that to the people of those different areas. So those people are on haqq, they are on deen, they are on religion. They are taking from Rasulullah ﷺ through the Sahaba and those that came after them. If you tell them, leave that, follow something else, they might consider it disbelief, yani kufr, to leave what they know that comes from Rasulullah and from the Sahaba. You know. So therefore, do not force them to do that. And Harun Rashid obeyed him. He's, if this is your wish, then never mind. He thought that it would have been the best thing to unify. Just like in our time also, there has been that call that, why we have different mazahib? Aren't we all Muslims? We should all be, you know, one. Why we have differences between in the ways that we pray or in the schools of thought? Are these schools of thought in the Quran? Are these schools of thought mentioned in the hadith? No. Therefore, we should go back to the Quran. And this is sounds nice, but in fact, this is an invitation to disaster and to batil and to falsehood in reality, because of the reason that Imam Malik gave to Harun al-Rashid. Before that, Imam Malik thought only the mazhab of Medina, because Medina is where the Prophet spent the last 10 years of the time of his life. Medina is where he founded the governance, Islamic governance of the city of Medina and its constitution. And also, this is how where the people lived after him, so they must know best, you know, how the Prophet practiced also. But because he wrote to Al-Layth ibn Sa'd in Egypt about this issue, Al-Layth ibn Sa'd convinced him with the same argument that later Malik gave to Harun al-Rashid. And the picture is bigger than that. So even though the practice of Medina is immensely respected and on our heads for sure, but at the same time, the whole of Sharia is not encompassed in one single place, is not encompassed in one single Sahabi or in 10 of them or more than that. It's encompassed in the Prophet ﷺ, and no one can encompass it like that after him. So, but all those that base everything that they practice, from the first to the last of the ibadat, first to the last of muamalat, on the way of Prophet ﷺ, but through this school of Sahabi and Tabi'in after them and so on, they are all on haqq. They are all on haqq. And the Prophet ﷺ gave examples that it can be two different interpretations, and for us, only one can be correct, but both of them were given equal reward. For example, in the hadith of do not pray Asr, but not until you reach the Banu Qurayza, to a group of Sahaba. So on their way, they were afraid that the time of Asr would elapse. So a group of them prayed early, and another group prayed late, and the Prophet ﷺ gave both of them the benefit of the doubt and accepted from both of them what they had decided. Sometimes the Sahaba also would interpret the verse of Tayammum, for example, to put the sand all over themselves. And others would say, no, it is enough, the faces and the hands. And the Prophet accepted from both of them, and he said, yes, it is enough for the face of the hands, and the other one is correct. So there is leeway, and the Prophet gave plenty of examples of leeway. And he even said, if one is incorrect, he will have one reward. If the other one makes ijtihad and thinks how to apply and is correct, he will have the reward of ijtihad and the reward of being correct. He will have two rewards. But each one that makes their effort on good basis, on qualified basis, then they have their reward. We are talking here about the effort of those who possess the knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah, and yet they do not find the answer to their particular problem in time. That's the ijtihad that we mean, not do it or yourself ijtihad without that qualification. And the example of that ijtihad is when the Prophet ﷺ sent Mu'az ibn Jabal to Yemen. He said, how are you going to judge when issues come up to you? He said, I will look in the Quran. If I find the answer there, I apply it. If not, I look in the Sunnah. I will apply the answer from there. If not, I will do my best. And I will leave no stone unturned in my effort. Yani ijtihad. I will أجتهد جهدي ولا آلو حتى يعني إن وفقني الله للجواب. يعني until Allah give me the success of answering correctly. And the Prophet ﷺ was very happy. He said, Alhamdulillah, who gave the messenger of the messenger of Allah this wisdom, this approach. So in other words, ijtihad on the basis of Quran and the Sunnah. And this is why they are called the imam, or mujtahid imams. These four imams were the mujtahid imams, yani the imams who applied their efforts, and it was not given to everyone to be able to apply their efforts like that. We do not consider that after that the door of ijtihad is closed, but it's just that imams such as these of this caliber that would encompass everything that they did, which is not the whole of the Sharia, but it comes the closest, that such caliber is now very hard or almost impossible to find. But we do find ijtihad at all times, but in particular issues. On issues that, like for example, certain scientific issues, medical issues or bioethical issues and so forth, there is ijtihad. There has to be. There has always to be answers to new problems. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as Allah sends also cures for each new disease as well. There is one, whether we know it or not. So it is the job of those who research to find it. Imam al-Shafi'i, as I wanted to say when I mentioned his risala, gave credit to Muhammad ibn al-Hasan as his teacher. And Muhammad ibn al-Hasan is one of the great students of Imam Abu Hanifa. So yet, al-Shafi'i acknowledged this debt that he had to Muhammad ibn al-Hasan. So in other words, he is in a way connected to Imam Abu Hanifa through that. And indeed, he said, "Al-nasu عيال على أبي حنيفة في الفقه." The saying of Imam al-Shafi'i that all people are indebted to Abu Hanifa in fiqh. So he was giving Abu Hanifa the credit of all subsequent jurisprudence that came after him. Similarly, al-Shafi'i was also a student of Imam Malik, whom he met when al-Shafi'i was only 12. And at that time, he memorized the Muwatta, and he also was very quickly giving signs that he was qualified to give fatwa. So Imam Malik was supporting him greatly. And after al-Shafi'i, let's not forget that Ahmad ibn Hanbal also studied under al-Shafi'i. In fact, Ibn Khuzaymah considered that the whole Hanbali Mazhab was in fact a branch of the Shafi'i Mazhab, which is an oversimplification. For sure, but he was referring to the fact that Ahmad was a student of Al-Shafi'i. So they are interconnected. What about the Imams of Hadith, Bukhari, Muslim, and so forth? What about the Imams of Hadith, such as Bukhari and Muslim, what was their mazhab? I also looked into that, into this book, and whoever they were contemporary to, I also analyzed parts of their life and parts of their methodology in this book. Shah Waliullah of Delhi, for example, he says that Al-Bukhari was a Shafi'i in fiqh, but it is not clear. Some of the fiqh of Al-Bukhari is Shafi'i, other is not. So you might be interested in just looking some and looking at some aspects of this book, not necessarily to read it from beginning to end. This is why I also put an index at the end so that you can look up any particular issues that you might be interested in. In the same way, the table of contents, especially in my latest books, including this one, I try to make it very detailed. This one, this way, you just look at the table of contents, you see whatever grabs your attention or that you are interested in particular, not have to read the book from A to Z or even any chapter of it from A to Z in order to find what you are particularly interested in. So some people, for example, attach to the mazhab of Imam Hanbal a certain prejudice. They say the Hanbalis, they all believe this or they all think like that. I try to take into consideration the general preconceived ideas that some people might have about this or that Imam and address those indirectly in the chapter related to that Imam, you see? So for example, I found that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal had a particular relationship with the Sufis of his time. And this is not expected from the Hanbali school. They think that people in general, or certain people might think that the Hanbali school is very strict against those things. In reality, I found that of all the four schools of Islam, these schools, the Hanbali school is the one that is most open and most practicing of tasawwuf in its early centuries. And beginning in the time of Imam Ahmad and his immediate successor. So I tried to show that salient point. Similarly, Al-Shafi'i as well. And another aspect of Imam Al-Shafi'i, other than tasawwuf, is that Imam Al-Shafi'i was immensely respectful of the family of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, because he is the only one of those four Imams who is actually related by blood to the Holy Prophet ﷺ. This is why, because he is a descendant of Al-Muttalib, Al-Shafi'i, so he is called Al-Imam Al-Muttalibi, the cousin of the father of the Prophet ﷺ. So therefore we mention that, and we mention also some of his poetry. He was a poet. He had memorized a lot of poetry. In fact, there is an anecdote that one time he was walking with Yahya ibn Ma'in and in one of the streets of Cairo, and they heard someone reciting poetry from a window. So Imam Al-Shafi'i said, stop, let's listen. And they were listening to the poetry being recited, and you know how they recited poetry in a sing-songy way, in an attractive way that beautified the words that were being recited. It also makes it easier to memorize and easier to listen to as well. So Imam Al-Shafi'i listened, and then said, okay, let's walk. And then he turned to Yahya ibn Ma'in and he said, do you feel moved by what we heard? And Yahya said, no. And Shafi'i said, then you have no dhawq, you have no taste. Which is very interesting, and which is quoted as one of the proofs also that one of the proofs of their differences over the issues of music, of listening to music as well. There is a report, for example, that Muawiyah, radiallahu anhu was seen listening to music that was being sung, and he was moving. He was moving his hand, he was moving his body, he was moving his head like this, and he was showing tarab. Tarab meaning this kind of pleasure that we experience with music, kind of enjoyment of music like that, with movement. And so they said, Amir al-Mu'mineen Yatrub, and here, yani, you are commander of the believers here in Syria, and you are showing this enjoyment, and you are not afraid of what people might think. And he said, well, Allah Yatrub al-Hur, yani, the free man is not allowed to experience pleasure with music. And it is a form of beauty, it's a form of art, and the free man is supposed to understand the beauty of things in life. So that's, this is what he replied. It is mentioned in Hilm Muawiyah, the wisdom or the wit of Muawiyah by Ibn Abi Dunya, so you can look it up, and in other works also connected to the topic of music. So it is interesting to see, to look at their fatwas on certain topics like that. We know that, for example, concerning music, the Shafi'i and Hanafi mazhab are quite strict. But we know that among the Sahaba, for example, the most